start up again in October, it needs to be open up to all the men. So all the men and young men are invited. This month, it's going to be October 15th at the Middletown Diner, where we meet from 10 to 12. And it's not a traditional men's Bible study or men's group. It's called a round table. And it's called a round table for a reason. It's a discussion, iron sharpening iron, encouragement with the word and the spirit of truth. So we want to encourage you guys to come join us from 10 to 12 on Saturday morning, October 22nd. With that, tomorrow night, the insiders will be at 7 o'clock in the church office. Did I miss anything else? I know a few people are out today for various reasons, so I'm trying to think of what they want to say. I think we're good at that point. So the children are free to go to children's church. It's been a while since we've really been saying that. So the kids are free to go to children's church right now. If you have your Bible, iPad, iPhone, tablet, any phone, we are in Romans chapter 1 today. We'll look at the first 12 verses. Romans chapter 12, chapter 1. We begin. Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, Paul, as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scripture, concerning his son, who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, who was declared the Son of God with the Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of the faith among all the Gentiles for his name's sake, among whom you also are the called of Jesus Christ. To all who are beloved of God and all, called as saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you, because your faith is proclaimed throughout the whole world. For God, whom I serve in my spirit in the preaching of the gospel of his Son, is my witness as to how unceasingly I make mention of you, always in my prayers, making requests, and perhaps now at last, by the will of God, I may succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you, so that I may impart some spiritual gift to you, that you may be established, that is, that I may be encouraged together with you, while among you, each of us by the other's faith, both yours and mine. So, I wanted to tell you the end of the message before I share with you the beginning. The climax of this message, this time of sharing, is what are you leaving behind? You know, when we go visit somebody, being Middle Eastern, the traditional thing is you never go to somebody's house, especially if it's a formal dinner, without bringing something with you. And if you bring something with you, especially if it's in your own plate or your own Tupperware or pot or whatever, generally you take it home with you, right? One way or another, whether the host cleans it and moves what was in it in the another dish, or you bring it home. You bring it home with you. But what's important is not what we bring back with us, but what we leave behind as Christians. And I'll show you how that plays out. Paul sets up the end with everything he says in the beginning to this church in Rome. And I want to go verse by verse, almost breaking this down. Because he begins by saying, I, Paul, a bond service in verse 1 of Jesus Christ, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel. He lays the foundation right there of what this is all about in those three simple statements. First thing, a bond servant. For those that don't know, a bond servant is somebody who was a slave, who now is legally free, but decides that out of love for their owner, to choose to stay under the covering of the owner. So it's by choice now, Paul has chosen to stay as a bond servant to Jesus Christ. Not because he is a slave, as we know Paul is very much like, I'm no longer a slave to the letter of the law, but now I am free in Christ. So he chooses in his freedom to love Jesus in the way he serves him. So he's making that statement, I'm no longer a slave to the law of religion, but I am choosing now to be under the loving grace of Jesus Christ. I am a bond servant of Jesus Christ. So he makes that clear. I do this by choice, by free will, out of love, and out of my heart's cry. And I am called as an apostle. So what does the word apostle here mean? The word is apostello in Greek, which means to commission, send forth. Properly, someone sent, focusing back on the authority. So you're sent, representing the one who sent you. When Paul talks about being an ambassador, that's what he's referring to. The authority of the one who sent you is with him. So as an apostle, the authority of the kingdom of heaven is what sent him, and he goes in, and he has power in and authority in. So everything that he is based on who sent him. Now think about this in our lives. Everything that we are as Christians, our identity, isn't on what we do. See, prior to his encounter with Jesus, Paul's identity was wrapped up in being, as he puts it, a Pharisee among Pharisees. A Pharisee of Pharisees. His identity was wrapped up in what he did religiously for God. Sometimes we get caught up in what we do, whether it's religiously for God or what we just do. Our identity isn't who we are, but on what we do. The label that we give ourselves. And the one label we miss out on is son and daughter. And in this case, apostle. Recognizing that as a son of God, Paul is freely choosing to be sent out by the Father, to fulfill the purpose and the glory of his kingdom, his Father's work. It's a choice. He is an apostle, somebody sent out, commissioned by the one sending him. Sending him. You know, this morning, and this is a little off topic, but it's not, as I was thinking about mentioning this men's round table to the church and making it, you know, opening up for all the men. Something the Lord reminded me that happened about 7 years ago, maybe even 8 years ago. We were in our old building, and this was a Wednesday night, and somebody else was leading worship, and I was just by myself in the very back of the church, and then standing in the middle of the aisle, and I heard the Holy Spirit say, get on your one knee, because I want to knight you and commission you as a knight. So I got on my one knee and I just had like this vision of the sword, God just taking his sword like a knight, knighting me. And the Lord reminded me of that this morning, because he said this round table is about knighting the men, knighting apostles. It's the knighthood, knights of the round table. It's symbolic of that. That's why he gave me the word knight round table for this. And I don't mean to stray off what we're talking about, but the purpose here is God's called all of us to be part, and he's commissioned, not just called, but as apostles. You may somebody might be an quote apostle so and so and have that apostolic anointing, like we had Apostle Kathy here a few weeks ago. But we are all being commissioned and sent out by the Father to complete the work of the Son, our brother in spirit, Jesus. We are sons and daughters to fulfill that purpose. So he says, I am a bondservant choosing to work in my Father's business. Called, and as an apostle, I am called. The word called is to be called, invited, summoned by God to an office. Summoned by God to an office or salvation. So God called me and said, hey, I want to commission you, Paul said, to do this. Will you choose to freely receive this anointing, this knighting, this knighthood, this commissioning to be sent out and do this thing? And then Paul said, yes, therefore he called himself a bond servant. And then he said, I am set apart for the gospel. I'm doing this because I have consecrated myself, positioned myself to do this without being distracted, without putting other priorities. I accept this as the highest priority in my life. This is not what I do. This is who I am. I am a bond servant, freely loving the one who sent me, who commissioned me, my Father in heaven. So everything he says from this point on is set up by those three or four little statements. Bond servant, called, apostle, and set apart for the gospel of God. But then he continues verse 2, which he promised beforehand through his prophets and the Holy Spirit. God designed, his design is for people to be called and set apart. Some of us have different areas that we are set apart for and have been commissioned for. You can call it anointings, you can call it giftings, you can call it talents, you can call it abilities. I call it back when Jeremiah, when he said, before I knew you, I called you a prophet. That I truly believe with everything in me, that when God thinks of how to design each one of us, before we are even birthed or placed into existence in our mother's womb, he designed us with the type of qualities and characteristics and spiritual DNA he wants us to have for a purpose. See, God looked at the purpose and says, I need somebody who's perfect to fulfill it in the way I would, who would steward it the way I would, just like Adam and Eve were called to steward the Garden of Eden. I want somebody perfect. So before I formed you, I knew you in the womb. I knew who I want you to be like, what I want you to be like in the womb before I formed you there, for you to fulfill what I have for you to fulfill. Now it's just up to us as human beings to come into agreement with that, right? That's our identity. We're basically coming into agreement with the identity that God has already called us to and established for us. Our human nature is the one that keeps us sometimes from seeing who we really are. God never stops seeing us outside of the realm of our identity. He keeps saying, would you come back to who you are? Would you just simply come back to what I created you to be? See, this is the challenge as parents. As parents, and praying for our children, we, you know, something we're still learning with Martha Allen, okay? Don't have it right. Still learning. Because Lord, what is her identity in you? And how do we as parents gear up, line up, how we raise her uniquely to fit that identity to the best that we possibly can so that she will always know and stay close to that line of where she's supposed to be that identifies who she is in you. Sticks close to that. Ultimately, she has to make her own choice. But as parents, how do we pray for that? How do we even discipline her in that manner? How do we speak to her? What do we declare over her? All those things. And that's the challenge for us as parents. And that's what God is continually doing as we are seeking Him. Part of this whole thing of being intimate with Jesus is hearing His voice declare who we are and lining us up as a father and as a mother, trying to continually line up their son or daughter to whom their identity is in Christ, what God has called them to be. That's what Jesus is constantly doing. That's what He did on the cross, to realign us to that. And that's what Paul is trying to always do with every church he goes to. I mean, sometimes you read some of the things Paul says, and man, he's harsh. He's blunt. But you know what? He's unmovable when it comes to the truth of the God, Spirit of God, and the Word of God, and the Kingdom of God. He will not bend the Word of God. He's unshakable. And He wants every child of His, whether it's Timothy, Titus, or any other spiritual children, or spiritual children in terms of church He plants, to stay true to the identity of the gospel of Christ that God created this church for in that specific region. Because just like we, as a church here, have our own purpose and identity from the church across the street, the church in Ephesus has its own identity from the church in Rome, or in Colossae, or in Philippi. Every one of those churches has their specific anointing, calling, identity. And Paul wants to fulfill this. And when he says, which he promised beforehand through his prophets and scriptures, everything God is doing is to draw us back to our purpose and identity in Him. And then he says in verse 3, concerning his son, who's born of a descendant of David according to the flesh. Again, connecting it to the Jewish scriptures, to the Torah, to the lineage, to David, that this is who Jesus is. Everything I do is based on who the person of Jesus is, because He is in me. He is in my life. It's His blood, His spiritual DNA flowing through me that keeps me lined up with Jesus, that gets me right when I start going astray. The beautiful thing is, and we were just talking about this on the drive to church today, you know, God is so graciously patient in His mercy and grace. He doesn't write us off when we screw up. He keeps drawing us and prompting us and encouraging us, come back. And He makes everything possible for us to come back in His grace. That's why David says His mercies are renewed every single morning. What happened yesterday is history because of the blood of Jesus, when I let His blood wash me clean. And I get to start over with Him. So He's connecting that. And it all ties into when He says, who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead according to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord. His divinity was proven by His resurrection. His divinity was proven by the fact that He rose. So if you're ever in doubt of who Jesus was, He's declaring to them. The fact that He rose should just quench that doubt. Everything I am is because Jesus rose. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, there would be nothing to talk about. He would just be a good prophet, a good teacher. That's it. Who taught good things about being morally right before God. But the fact that He rose, and He rose from the dead according to the Spirit of holiness, that's the clincher there. Spirit of holiness is spirit, wind, breath, ruach. And holiness, which focuses on the Holy Spirit influence. This is what it's Greek reference to and meaning. Holiness, the word holiness, which is another word for sanctification, means which focuses on the Holy Spirit's influence of preparing the believer for eternity. Expresses this transformation as a character quality that comes by the grace of God. So the same thing, same spirit of holiness that rose Jesus up from the dead, that prepared him for eternity, because remember, fully human and fully God. But now, all bets are off. He's raised from the dead. He's now being prepared for eternity. That's why he told them when they were going to touch him after he was first raised, don't touch me yet. I haven't gone up to my Father yet to be, you know, glorified. Hold on a second. There's some things first. But in that spirit of holiness, he's preparing us the same way for eternity. How does he prepare us? He lines us back up with our identity that he created us for and in. He realigns us to his purpose and plans that are always good. Good. In our lives. He realigns us in those things. Then he says in verse 5, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of the faith among all the Gentiles. What is grace? The word grace here is favor, disposed to, inclined, favorable towards, as a gift or blessing brought to man by Jesus Christ. Gratitude. So we have received his favor, his gratitude, his blessing, and apostleship, his commissioning. We've received the favor, the grace, everything we need to be commissioned and be who we're supposed to be in this land. It's another way of saying what we read about in Ephesians 1:3. We have every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realm in Christ Jesus available to us. It's another way of saying that. But he's saying with it, you've got an apostleship. You've got an anointing. You've got a call. You've been commissioned and you've been sent out, not by an angel, not by a supervisor, but you were sent out by the head of the company, the Father. You've been commissioned by him. You went to the throne room of Jesus Christ, and you have his blessing. He said, well done. I'm proud of you. You're right where I want you to be. You're moving the way I called you to be. I love your heart. You may not be perfect. You're going to make mistakes here and there, but that's okay. Just get your focus back on me when you do, and let's keep pressing forward. Let's just keep doing this thing. I've commissioned you for this, to bring the Gentiles into the fold. Nowadays, bring everybody into the fold. You're there to make an influence wherever you are. Now, in order to bring the Gentiles into the fold, you have to go to the Gentiles. He doesn't say, open your door and say, Gentiles, come in. He doesn't say, open your door and say, we're a church, come in. I've never seen anybody knocking on the door of a church to come in unless they're going through a tragedy. Let's just be honest. But they will come into a fold when they know they're being loved, when it's real. They will know, they will want to be part of a family when they know what you carry is genuine and real, and that they could belong. When they get to know that they can be everything they're called to be, but until then, they're accepted as they are and loved on the way they are. Okay? Just get up, go, you are commissioned. Go in your neighborhood, go to your neighbor, go to your workplace. Well, you know, we talk about this all the time. I know I'm preaching. many ways to the choir here about it. But it's about being commissioned to be more than just the affliction church. Okay? We have to. Thank you for sharing the testimony about what happened at your mom's services and your time there. Because that's encouraging. That shows that this family was a family, revealed itself as a family of God. And I'm going to say Gentile only in the reference to the fact that many did not know Jesus Christ or don't have a relationship with him right now. So we went to them. We didn't say, just come to our church and we'll love you. We went to them in love. And that's what Paul is encouraging us to do. That's what Paul is doing. He's encouraging us. And this is what he says, among whom, verse 6, you also are the called of Jesus Christ. That same word Paul he's talking to us about is the same word in Greek that he talked about himself earlier. I am called to be invited, summoned by God to an office. That's the definition of it. So this is saying, listen, you might look at me as some big boy, but guess what? You are also summoned by God. You can do what I can do. And maybe some of it better than me. Because you have your own little niche. Sharing with Amanda before church today, she has her niche with the New Age group. She can do that hands down thousands of times better than I could even come close to. Because she's called. She has been appointed by God for that. He has summoned her to hold that office. And when God summons you to hold an office, no one can take that from you. People may put you down. People may critique you. But nobody can take you. Remove the position that God puts you in. The only way we lose the position God puts us in is if we have to. That's it. Nobody can take that from you. And unfortunately, over the years, I've seen many people choose to abdicate that position. But here's the thing. God is so good. Because when we do, the grace, the anointing, the mantle that is on that goes on someone else who's willing to say that. That's a different message. But then he continues. I thank God for him. Thank my God for Jesus Christ for you guys. And he talks about them, how he longs to see them. But I want to skip down now to verse 11. As he says, I'm doing my best to try to come to you. I pray it's God's will for me to come to you. But then he says, this is why. And everything he's talked about to this point sets up this. For I long to see you so that I may impart some spiritual gift to you, that you may be established. He wants to see them to leave something with them. He wants to see them to release something into their lives, to activate them. To give them something that God has given him. He wants to leave them. Right? He wants to give of himself, pass on something he has. I long to see him part. God has blessed him with so many things. And he said, man, God continues to bless me, and I'm never going to lack, no matter what I give away. God will continue to give. When I give away, all I'm doing is making room more for God to give me more. That's it. I will never be depleted. That's the beautiful thing about the Holy Spirit. The more we release, the more he pours in. Think back of, I think it's Elijah, he's a woman with the oil. As long as she kept bringing empty jars, they kept getting filled with oil. oil stopped when the jar stopped coming. Right? The more we have room to receive, the more God wants to pour in. Give away. Give it away so he can give it up and pour it in. And I want to impart. I offer by way of change. The word impart means to offer by way of change. Offer so that the change of owner is produced. Think about it. I'm giving you something and it becomes yours. I've got something good that I want to give to you. I want to leave with you, but it's yours now. It's not mine. It's yours. You are now taking authority and ownership of it. So when I pray, if I have a prophetic gift and I lay hands and impart that and pray that the person I'm praying for receives my prophetic gift, and I'm transferring that to them, but it's not mine now anymore. I still have my prophetic gift, but now God will take it and mold it into who that person is, and it becomes part of who they are and their identity as God is realigning them into who they're created to be. In the church, we miss that. And growing up, I missed that. I never had somebody pray and release an impartation on me of something till about 5-6 years ago. And man, we just want to give it away. Every time we go somewhere and we get something new, I can't wait to come home to you all to release it. Because it isn't mine to hold on to and stick in some display cabinet. It's mine to give away and release to you so that you can grow and release it to someone else. And Paul is saying, I can't wait to do that. I just can't simply wait to do that to you. And what this will do to you is it will establish, he says, that you may be established, which means the word establish here means, or you can replace it with the word to strengthen you. And it means in Greek, fix firmly, to direct myself towards, to support, to strengthen. A support that fixes and plants down. In other words, it makes something unshakable. It's not just strengthening you so you can feel good about yourself. Yeah, I'm confident now. But it strengthens you. To establish something is a reference to make stand, properly set fast. Part of the definition actually says, which eliminates vacillation, swaying back and forth. So what I want to impart to you, I want to give you of myself, is something that's going to help strengthen your resolve and your foundation of faith that will make you unshakable in your relationship with Jesus Christ. I want to leave that with you. So you will be so strong that nothing will shake you. Nothing will shake you. And then he says, that is that I may be encouraged together with you while among you, each of us by the other's faith, both yours and mine. I was sharing with a fellow pastor on Friday, and met him. We were just having coffee and talking. And we were both talking, you know, I mean, we're not old, but I'm 53. He's almost 60. And we've been both in the ministry for a long time. And there's not much that impresses us anymore when we're talking about that. Used to be, I'd be like, wow, I want to be just like him. Look how great they preach. Whoa, I'm so intimidated. Now that I know what I know it's God. It's not me. There's nothing I can do that can impress anybody. It's only God working through me, just creating an avenue that will do wonderful things. Whether as a musician, leading worship, or preaching, or whatever. I mean, I'm just a noisy gong if the Spirit of God isn't flowing. It's just empty. I want to talk about how, you know, not much impresses us. one thing does still impress me. When I see someone that I love, someone young, step growing in the faith, and now beginning to step out of the faith, preaching for the first time, laying hands and praying for healing for the first time, prophesying for the first time, praying in the spirit and tongues for the first time, and beginning to move in the power of God for the first time. That excites me. That makes me feel so good. Because then I know this person has said yes to God. They're working towards realigning themselves to what their created identity and purpose is. And they're letting God work through them to work through the kinks of that project. That's what impresses me. That's what gets me excited. And that's what Paul is saying here, that I may be encouraged together with you. You're going to be excited at what you got. And you got, in a way, I'm not making light of this, but you almost have like a new toy to play with. You got something now that you didn't have before, and it excites you like a kid with a new toy. Man, when I had the impartation to start praying for healing, that's exciting. I love to pray for somebody, especially if they're not of that ilk of in the flow of receiving prayer for healing, and the look on their face when, wait a minute, what just happened? How did you do that? That excites me and excited me. And to see now somebody who I would call a spiritual son or daughter, no matter what the age, actual age is, doing the same, that's exciting. And that's what Paul is saying. I may be encouraged when I see you doing the awesome things that was imparted, that I can impart and give you. Anything I can give you to make you better and be everything you're supposed to be in Christ Jesus, I want to do, even if it's a little thing or a big thing. If I come to your house, going back to, you know, being invited to dinner somebody, with a little rose, or I come to your house with this great big tray from Dixie Lee Bakery, doesn't matter. If I can leave it for you, and if it can bring you that much closer to Jesus Christ and who you are in him, that's what I want. That's what's exciting to me. That's how iron sharpens iron. Because you know what? If I pray and impart a gift of healing onto you, guess who's going to need that gift of healing one day? It's me. I get to return the blessing because you get to pray for me. And I'm not so old or, quote, experienced in ministry that I can't learn from somebody preaching their very first sermon or giving their very first teaching or releasing their very first word of God. I can learn. I can receive. I can receive. I don't care what your age is or how new in the faith you are, it doesn't matter. I can receive. And that is exciting. That's what Paul is excited about. He is super encouraged by them receiving what he is given, then utilizing it, using it. Because Paul would not release something if he knew, as he calls it, pearls before swine. I'm not going to give something to somebody who I know I won't receive. But if you're willing to receive it, then you're willing to do something with it. And that's beautiful. So that takes us back now to the beginning as we close. What are we leaving behind? When I walk into a home with somebody who's as marked with it, not yet believing, I may not necessarily release something and leave behind something that's so dramatic or powerful as it may be if I were in a believer's home. And maybe powerful is the wrong word, because it is powerful. But what can I leave behind that would bring them even the slightest bit closer to who they are? My love? My words of encouragement? Maybe just, hey, I heard what you said earlier, I just want to bless you in the name of Jesus, that this will go right through. That's it. Because some, that's all they can handle. That's all they can handle. It would be as simple that there was somebody who, you know, this week is part of the things that went on with Mark's family, who I know is not totally open to receiving deep, intense prayer, but it's got some procedure coming up. So, very nonchalantly, just put my hand on the shoulder. I just bless you that everything goes well with your procedure. Bless the doctor. Bless you with peace. That you prepare and everything go well. And that's it. No, oh, let's pray. Oh, Father.
Yeah.
No. Leave something with him because that's what's going to be remembered. That's what's going to be the seed that will grow into something more. That's been our prayer with our time, with your family, everyone else there, Mark. But that's what Paul is doing, and he's encouraging us to do. The only thing we need to do is be a little more conscious. Lord, what can I leave behind? When I'm hanging out with a secular friend, an unsaved friend, you have to be saved first. In their home. Lord, what can I leave in this home? What can I leave with that will just honor you and bring you that much hope that we can build upon next time? When I run into somebody at the gym or in the streets or wherever I am, what gift can I leave with them? Stand with me right now as we close. And for you guys at home, whatever we release in here, I just release it where you are as well. That you are touched, and that you are encouraged, and you feel the presence of the Holy Spirit ministering to you tonight. So just position yourself to receive right now. Holy Spirit, just come. I just release an impartation right now of an awareness and an understanding of seeing and sensing in our spiritual senses the environment we enter. And simply asking you, Lord, right now, what would you like me to leave behind when I leave here? What can I give of myself that's from you in this place? Some of us go into churches that we need to leave some things behind there as well. Lord, we thank you that you pour out your spirit into us. We thank you that we are the funnel that can pour out your spirit here as well. That would you release that in us right now, wherever we may be. Anthony and Allison, I know Elise mentioned this earlier, but I'm feeling this in my spirit right now. You guys left something major behind when you taught me today. I'm really feeling the spiritual weight of what you guys left behind to those who hurt me. So thank you, Lord. Thank you that you would grow to heaven. Thank you, Father. Thank you. I want to hear your Holy Spirit say, and this is not just for those that are here right now live, but you guys at home too, hear your Holy Spirit say, you don't realize the influence you have where you are. Just think about how much more it's going to be when it's a little more intentional, because we're actually coming into agreement with God by simply saying, God, what would you like me to do? Because now it's a little more focused and intentional and purposeful. I'm so proud of y'all. And it's going to happen even bigger. So, Lord, I just release that over each person that they know. If their eyes will see, I'm releasing right now an anointing of this, all the senses. If your eyes will see what the flesh can't see, the ears will hear what the natural hearing can't hear, the heart will know what the heart of the Father would know, that the hands would be able to do and touch. But in the natural, they're not aware that they are doing the touching. And that the mind would know and understand through the mind of Christ. And the nose will smell the aroma of heaven that is working and flowing, the incense from heaven that we are coming into agreement with, that is taking place wherever we may be. Thank you, Lord. God doesn't have a sense of humor, because I'm told it's simply that. Stop beating yourself up and don't take yourself too seriously. Just flow with me. That's what I just heard him say. Stop beating yourself up. And just stop taking yourself too seriously. Just flow with me. When you mess up, get up. And keep going. My blood covers the multitude of sins. In Jesus' name. I'm going to release you now. Sit with the Lord as long as you need to sit with the Lord. And when you're done, you're done. Have a blessed week.